You're listening to Odd IC, A Tale from the Road, an audiobook by Christopher Colon. All rights reserved. Any resemblance to persons living or dead are purely coincidental.
Chapter 42. I was reminded of the scene at the end of the movie The Wizard of Oz. The scene where Dorothy realizes that it was all a dream, and all the characters that she had met on her journey to Emerald City, were representations of people she knew in real life. As she recognized each person, Dorothy says, "And you were there, and you were there." Every person in the governor's entourage was a familiar face to me. The first person through the door was Governor Ellis, himself. He was tall, handsome, and very imposing. His presence filled the room, like so many other men before him in positions of power. He reminded me of Abraham Lincoln and JFK, men whose statures alone had predetermined their rise to greatness. But Governor Ellis's reputation also preceded him. He was charismatic, fair, and benevolent. I had never met him before tonight, but I was certainly familiar with his face, from television and the newspapers. He pulled out his huge hand in my direction. I returned in kind, but feared that he might crush my hand with his firm handshake. Any future career as a guitar player would be ruined. He smiled his million-dollar smile and said, "How are you?" "I'm Governor Ellis," as if I had been living under a rock. Actually, seeing how I had been surviving on the road for the past couple of years, living under a rock, wasn't much of an improvement. Behind the governor, entered two twin towers. Now that they were standing side by side, they were unmistakably brother and sister. Their faces shared the same template. It was the slight variances in their mostly androgynous features that defined their true sex. I can't believe, I couldn't put those two faces together before I was told who they were. Like their father, Minerva, and postman Stephen, had undeniable statures, heads above the rest. After the twins made their way into the room, Layla and the blind man, Bruce Johnson, entered. She was leading him in, by the hand. As soon as Layla saw me, she dropped the blind man's hand, ran across the room and almost tackled me in an embrace. She knocked the wind out of me as her body slammed against mine and she wrapped her arms around my neck and shoulders. She forcefully pressed her lips against my cheek and repeatedly kept pecking at the side of my face in smooches. Between each kiss, she kept saying thank you, thank you, thank you. She was appreciative. I had reunited her with her childhood mentor and was expressing her gratitude the best way she knew how. I grew embarrassed by this display of affection in front of Penny and even Minerva. I had a lot of explaining to do. I wasn't encouraging her behavior, but then again, I wasn't exactly quick to pull her off me either. It was all completely innocent, but I don't know if Penny or Minerva saw it that way. Stephen then addressed me, "The gang's all here, Andy. Minerva and I were so happy we found you, alive, at the Calypso Lounge. And after we heard the news that Gateway Drug was breaking up, we started to organize tonight's meeting. I'm glad we found you in good time." Governor Ellis then drew his attention towards me, from his son's preamble, "Oh, so you're the one, whose friends were in trouble." What was he talking about, in trouble? As much as the guilt of losing my bandmates laid heavy on my shoulders, I haven't put much thought on what really might have happened to them. I thought that Arnie's dirty cops had taken my friends and put them in a watery grave. They would be sleeping with the fishes by now. It would be the understatement of the century, if the governor had used the term in trouble to discern that my bandmates were dead. What did he know that I didn't? My friends were arrested at the Rey del Sol Casino. They were caught by dirty cops. I then got indignant towards his honor, the governor, dirty cops who were on your brother's payroll. I'm sure they're dead by now. Or, at least, locked away in a basement somewhere being tortured with jumper cables and a car battery. The governor had looked shocked at first. He quickly regained his composure. This was the natural instinct of a politician. He then looked at me assuredly, "Heavens no, son. What kind of state do you think I run? Your friends are still in custody. I've seen the security tape. Your friend was stealing from the buffet. He's no innocent angel. But I assure you, they aren't in any real danger." I locked eyes with Minerva. She knew exactly what I was thinking. Why didn't she tell me my friends were safe? She started to explain herself, "I'm sorry I didn't tell you sooner, Andy. I knew my uncle was after you guys for what you did to Gabby. I went looking for you guys. Then I found out that they all got arrested. But you were missing. I recognized your bandmates' names from the police blotter. I called my dad, and he got them transferred to different precinct, out of harm's way. Somewhere Arnie's men couldn't get to them. Then Stephen and I found you, and we set up tonight. I wanted to be mad at Minerva. I wanted to scream at her for deceiving me. I had to put myself in check. I just didn't receive the whole truth. For her own reasons, she felt that it would be to my benefit to keep me in the dark. No doubt, she had saved my friend's lives. I should be grateful. After the anger washed out of me, I was. She loved me, and in turn, loved my friends. If I yelled at her now, it would just prove what a schmuck I had become. Can someone please tell me, what the hell is going on? Penny said, addressing the traveling circus that had invaded her dressing room. It's a long story, I assured her, when tonight's over, I promise to tell you the whole thing. When tonight's over, I'm going to a studio in California, lock myself away for a couple of months and record my solo album. She looked towards the door, knowing that the suits were just a few feet away, standing sentry just outside. It's all planned out, after tonight. We have the producers lined up, image consultants, public relations people, and a whole touring band of hired guns. The only piece missing is me. I thought things were going to be different. By the way you were acting, I thought you were ready to tell these suits to take a hike. It's almost like you want to sell out. I mean, what about your bandmates? I was stricken by a tinge of guilt thinking about my own abandoned bandmates. You're ready to give up your real band for a touring band? Do you really want to surround yourself with a bunch of yes men? Because that's what you're doing when you tour with hired guns. They just want a paycheck. They'll get up in front of thousands of people and play Twinkle, Twinkle Little Star if you tell them to. None of them will challenge you, not the way your true bandmates and friends will do. You can't grow if you're not challenged. You'll become stagnant. Penny became defensive. I'm not selling out. I don't need to take this kind of abuse. You're a guest in my dressing room, not the other way around. I've established myself as an artist. If I want to expand myself as a solo artist, that's my prerogative. You just play in a cover band. The truth hurts, especially if it comes from someone you care about. I had built her up in my head for so long, I'd forgotten that there was a real human being behind this rock star legend. She lashed out at me and rightfully so. I had accused her of one of the worst offenses in our world, a sellout. But she was right. What the hell have I ever accomplished that can compare to her proven track record? I must have struck a nerve, to get such a reaction from her. Penny must have seen the look of distress in my face. Her humility quickly returned, I'm sorry. I didn't mean to be hurtful. It's just that I'm under so much stress. The instant, I was quoted that I was thinking about going solo, these suits came out of the woodwork. Penny motioned towards the door. They were sent by the record company to keep an eye on me and to get things in order for the solo album. Since then, there had been terrible tension between me and my bandmates. I've tried to approach them, but the suits keep interfering. I don't really want to break up with my band, I just wanted to do a solo side project, something to expand my horizons. I tried to be crafty and stall this farewell show as long as possible, but the suits finally saw through my deceitful tactics and they started to plan tonight's show without my permission. I love my band and I love my fans. They're all the reason I continue to make music. But what about me? What about what I want to do? Will I ever get a chance to do what I want to do? Without being second-guessed? Or, just plain, flat out, told what I'm supposed to do, a Penny started to cry. I looked around the room. Even the confident governor looked at a loss for words. It killed me to see Penny cry like that. It's real easy to forget that other people have problems also. When Penny played guitar, she was a goddess on stage. The whole crowd would be at her mercy. Now she was crying. Her fragile facade was broken. These suits had done quite a number on her, controlling her every move, and not letting her talk to her own trusted friends. She was isolated from the world. Miraculously, we had gained an audience with her, on this, her final night as a member of a band. Once she went solo, there would be nobody there give her honest criticism. She would be living in a distilled world, where every action would be praised as if she found a cure for cancer or something. It was too solitary, too refined. Nobody would be there to put her in her place when she needed to be. In time she would become a megalomaniac, drunk off her own power and bullshit. She would self-destruct under her own weight of excess and narcissism. I've seen it happen time and time again, and I didn't want to see that happen to her. I would not let her sell out. I sat down next to Penny and put a reassuring arm around her. "We're not going to let anybody get to you." Penny lifted her wet face. "What are you talking about?" she said, still slightly sobbing. Thoughts quickly flooded my mind on the spot. I said in my best impersonation of a suit voice, "Miss Penny, I would like to introduce you to your new team of representatives and advisors. My name is Andy, I will be your road manager, in charge of your band's road crew. Trust me, I have lots of experience in that field." I then started to point to each of the other people in our entourage. "This is Bruce Johnson, he will be in charge of your sound checks. He has an ear for music. This is Layla, she will be in charge of your accommodations. Hotel rooms and nice dressing rooms, like this one. This is Stephen Ellis, he will be in charge of your band's equipment. He knows how to get things packed up on trucks. The Honorable, Governor Ellis, legal advisor." Like there was any other choice. "And last, but certainly not least, Minerva Ellis. She will be your general manager and liaison with the record company. If the record company even looks at you crooked, she will put them in their place. Nobody from our group objected to my assignments. And we'll make sure to keep your best interests at heart," I promised her.
Please visit twostrangersonepodcast.net.